All right, guys, so let's go ahead and talk about one of the most important topics in thermodynamics, which is using bond dissociation energies to calculate the enthalpy of a reaction. All right, so bond dissociation energies are values that are going to describe the strength of chemical bonds. All right, now in chemistry courses that are way beyond the level of this course, organic chemistry, we actually can use math to figure out exactly why two atoms have the exact strength of bond that they do, okay? But in this course, you're never going to be asked that. You're never going to be asked to explain why the bond between H and H is 436 kilojoules per mole, okay? That's not going to happen. So these are going to be basically experimental values that you're going to be given that you're going to use as reference to just figure out one question. Is this going to be an exothermic reaction or is this going to be an endothermic reaction? Now keep in mind, just because we know the enthalpy doesn't mean that we actually know the spontaneity. Remember that the enthalpy is just one component of the spontaneity. We're also going to need to know the temperature and the delta S. But for right now, all we're worrying about is the delta H. We're just saying, is this exothermic or endothermic? All right, so let's remind ourselves of what exothermic means. It just means that I'm going to get a negative energy at the end. And what that means is that I'm making bonds. Remember that it's favorable to make bonds. You release energy as you save energy between those orbitals, okay? And then if I get a positive value, that means I'm breaking bonds, because remember, it takes energy. I have to put energy into the system to make these atoms fly apart again, all right? So here I've given you guys my own chart of bond dissociation energies. All these values should be exactly the same to whatever chart you're going to be given. The only thing I did is I just didn't want to take up a full page with every single value. So I just gave you guys some of the most important ones here. And as you can see, they're basically broken up into bonds of hydrogen. So I'm just going to put hydrogen bonds, even though don't get that confused with hydrogen bonding. That's just something different. Okay. Then I put here methyls. Okay. So things bonded to methyl. And then finally, basically like things bonded to each other. I don't know how to say that better. But just like methyl to methyl, oxygen to oxygen, stuff like that. Okay, so you guys could see just the general trends. And what you can see is that there's a general trend that as my atoms get bigger, okay, as my atoms get bigger, what's going to happen is that these bonds are going to get weaker. Okay, so you can see how it's not perfect. It's not a perfect trend. And like I said, you have to use very complicated math to defend it. But as a general rule, what we can say is that as these atoms that are attached to each other get bigger, the bonds are a little bit weaker, and that has to do with the distance between them, okay? These bigger atoms are going to have a farther distance than the smaller ones, all right? So one of the weakest bonds here is going to be II. Why? Because those are two humongous atoms that are trying to make a bond to each other. They're going to be much further apart than hydrogen-hydrogen will be. And that can partially explain the huge difference in energy between hydrogen-hydrogen and iodine-iodine, all right? So, as I just told you, if we make a bond, that's gonna be a negative value. So that means that I would assign a negative value to whatever bonds I'm making, okay? So if I make an HOH, that means I would put a negative value on that. If I'm breaking a bond, then I'm gonna assign a positive value to that, okay? So what I want you guys to do for the next two problems is I want you guys to analyze the reaction that's taking place. You don't need to know the mechanism. You don't need to know exactly what's going on. But what you do need to know is, okay, which bonds are being broken, which bonds are being made, all right? And then assign values to those using the chart that I gave you above. At the end, after you sum all of that together, you're going to know the enthalpy of the reaction, and you're going to be able to tell me, is this exothermic or endothermic? So go ahead and try it for yourself.